Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Yeah. So it's always a great pleasure to be in Trieste. I'm very grateful for this invitation. So I'm going to be the first speaker on exciton polaritons. So I will give some short introduction on this subject, which then will be addressed by several speakers in this meeting. So I will present a theoretical work. I'm a theorist. And this work has been done in collaboration with Alexander Sheremet from Russian Quantum Center in Moscow, Yura Rubo, who is here from UNAM, Cuernavaca, Mexico, and Ivan Shilik, who is now working in Iceland and Singapore. So this will be about some fundamental properties of exciton polaritons, superposition, light, matter, quasi-particles. And I will start from the overview of recent experiments, which attracted a lot of attention to this field. And then I will try to analyze the intrinsic structure of this interesting quasi-particle, unusual quasi-particle exciton polariton, and we'll try to link it with some philosophical questions of quantum mechanics. So the recent really avalanche of publications was devoted to the realization of this device, which is called polariton laser. The concept was proposed by Imamoglu and Yamamoto in 95, and it is quite simple. So imagine you have an optical cavity. So these are dielectric Bragg mirrors that confine light within this green layer. And this green layer is a semiconductor where you can inject either optically or electronically through contacts, electrons and holes. These electrons and holes can form excitons. Now, what happens? That exciton, the dispersion of exciton is shown on this scheme by the horizontal line. In principle, exciton has a parabolic dispersion, but on this scale, you would not see this parabola. It is like a straight line. So exciton can be coupled, even strongly coupled to light, which means that it can emit photon, but then photon comes back, reabsorbs, and what exactly happens there is actually the subject of my talk. Just the consequence of this interaction, which is not a subject of my talk, but something you can find in textbooks now, is the modification of dispersion of eigenmodes of this system. So instead of the exciton dispersion, which is this one, and the photon dispersion, which is parabolic because photon is confined in this direction, so the wave vector of light is fixed in this direction, and you can only vary wave vector in plane. That's why you obtain this parabolic dispersion with very light effective mass. So as a result of this coupling, you have two new dispersion branches, which are called exciton polaritons. From the point of view of quantum mechanics, these are superposition exciton photon states. And what it means, I'm going to discuss today. So far, just let us assume that it is so, and let us inject these exciton polaritons in the system. Then, due to the excitonic component, they can interact with photons, for example, or between each other, or with free carriers, if there are any free carriers in this system. And due to these interactions, they can relax their energy down to the bottom of the low polariton branch. So this is the low polariton branch, this is the upper polariton branch. As a result, in the bottom of this low polariton branch, you can form what can be called Bose-Einstein condensate of exciton polaritons. Here I must have mentioned that excitons are, of course, bosons because they are like Cooper pairs. They are composed by two fermions. An electron is a fermion, a hole is a fermion. So put two fermions together and you have a boson. And photons are bosons, of course. So this superposition quasi-particle, which is part exciton, part photon, is necessarily boson. It follows bosonic statistics, even though we are out of equilibrium, usually. There is pumping, there is decay in this system because light can go away tunneling through the mirror. Nevertheless, one can hope to be able to create a macroscopically populated single quantum state somewhere here near the bottom of the low polariton branch. Now, this state would, of course, also be characterized by some decay, some radiative decay, because light can go away from the structure by tunneling through these mirrors. There is no ideal mirrors in the world, and even if you have the best quality cavity, your reflection coefficient is something like 99.9%. That means that after just maybe 25 picoseconds, your photon will go away from the cavity. And then you can detect it. You can see light going out from the cavity. So the idea of Imamoglu and Yamamoto was that this light, which is emitted spontaneously, there is no stimulated emission here. It is spontaneous emission by the condensate. But still, this light will have all properties of laser light. It will be monochromatic. It will be characterized by a fixed wave vector, which is perpendicular to the surface of the cavity. And it is expected to be coherent, because this light is generated by a coherent quantum state, many-body quantum state, which is the condensate of exciton polarity. So formally, it will be laser, but laser without a stimulated emission of radiation, the laser without inversion of population, so a kind of unusual laser, bosonic laser. And after some discussion, the term polariton laser was accepted, I believe, by the major part of the community. So now this device is referred to as a polariton laser. So these polariton lasers have been realized. And the most famous paper is by the next speaker, Peter Littlewood, and co-authors, where the Bose-Einstein condensation of exciton polaritons was demonstrated at 5 Kelvin in cadmium telluride microcavity. But I should say that for polariton lasing, you don't necessarily need, strictly speaking, Bose-Einstein condensation, because you do not care of thermodynamics. You do not really need a thermal equilibrium in the system. The only thing you need for the laser is to have this condensate, so to put many identical exciton polaritons in the same quantum state. What happens in other quantum states, either they are, either their population is described by some equilibrium wave function, equilibrium distribution function or not, is not so important. So there were many papers where polariton lasing was reported, not necessarily Bose-Einstein condensation, and there is still debate on what should be called Bose-Einstein condensation, what should be called polariton lasing. So this is beyond the scope of my talk. I just want to emphasize that now polariton lasers are realized in many systems, and they are realized also at room temperature in wide band gap semiconductors. So there is an overwhelming, I would say, evidence that one can create condensates, bosonic condensates, of this half light, half matter quasi-particles called exciton polaritons. Now I come to actually to the topic of this our work, which is kind of rhetoric question. What is an exciton polariton? So what are in detail, how this superposition quasi-particles are organized? What really happens inside the microcavity? Okay, superposition means that you are, for example, half exciton, half photon. Of course, there are many superposition states in nature, and it is not surprising to have a superposition state. Even circularly polarized light can be considered as superposition of two linearly polarized lights. But here, the peculiarity is that it is a superposition of two quite different objects. Because one of them is a matter quasi-particle exciton, which has an effective mass, which has some dimension, Bohr radius, can interact with other particles, etc. Can be decomposed, after all. It can be decomposed into an electron and hole. And another part of this state is a photon. So what could be the microscopic image of this exciton polariton? So let us first of all consider not a microcavity, but just a crystal slab. Let us say this is some semiconductor crystal, and we have a single photon source, and we send a photon to this semiconductor slab. So with some probability, this photon can just go through and ignore, I mean, it can be absorbed, but it can be not absorbed. So it can just propagate through and you will detect photon at the exit. But of course, there is a probability that it is absorbed and it creates an exciton. So one image of exciton polariton is a naive image, I would say, is the following, that your photon enters to the crystal, propagates for some time, then at some stage it creates an exciton. Exciton is a very heavy compared to photon, so it almost does not move, so it moves very, very slowly, then it recombines and creates another photon, which keeps propagating and then creates again exciton, et cetera, et cetera. So it is a chain of emission and absorption and re-emission acts. It looks like an incoherent picture, but why not? I mean, there are situations, well, of course, absorption and re-emission are very well-known phenomena and may be observed in different systems. So this, at least this scheme is not self-contradictory. But the most generally accepted is a different scheme. The most generally accepted is this one, that you arrive and immediately inside this crystal, you do not have a photon, you do not have exciton, but you have this exciton polariton. So from the first works of the pioneers of this area, Agranovich and Hopfield, this is the generally accepted point of view. And if we speak in terms of classical optics, we describe these exciton polaritons by modifying the dielectric response function of this crystal. So here light propagates according to its dispersion law in vacuum, and here it propagates according to some different dispersion law, which is obtained taking into account light-matter coupling in a semiconductor. So there is no excitons, no photons here, but there is a new mode, exciton polariton, which exists from this point to this point, and then at the back edge, it converts again to photon. So it reminds this famous discussion of Bohr and Einstein on the nature of wave function. So I will come back to this thing again, but let us remember these two images. One is what I would call a statistical model, where we have real excitons, real photons, and real acts of absorption and emission, maybe stochastic. So we do not know where photon will convert to exciton and where exciton will convert to photon, but we know that something happens here and we have excitons and photons and they really exist in the structure. And the other image is that there is no excitons and photons. There are completely new quasi-particles, which are these superposition particles, exciton polaritons. So no emission, no absorption acts, just this conversion of photon to exciton polariton and back on the surface. Now, if we look at the microcavity structure, then it becomes even more tricky, because usually in these microcavities, excitons can only be created in a quantum well, so not here. So away from the quantum well, you really cannot have any exciton. You just have photon, and then it is, it looks like a photon can go through the quantum well, or it can be absorbed in a quantum well, convert to this red tomato-looking exciton, and this is a stochastic process. But on the other hand, one can say that maybe this is the case in what is called weak coupling regime, where people speak about independently about exciton and photon, but it would not apply to the strong coupling regime, which is the most interesting for polariton lasing, where due to the coupling between exciton and photon, we have two new eigenstates, which are the superposition states. So maybe the answer is that in weak coupling, we do really have excitons and photons, but this cannot no more be applied to the strong coupling regime. And, sorry again for this, okay, let us go here. This is reminiscent to, again, the discussion of godfathers of quantum mechanics on the nature of wave function. So suppose that we can capture this particle, we can do the measurement. And of course, when we measure, when we are doing the measurement, we can see either photon, for example, like in a photoluminescence experiment, or an exciton. For example, we can split an exciton into the couple of electron and hole, and it contributes to the electric current. So when we do measurements, so necessarily we kill exciton polariton. We have either exciton or photon. Now, the difference between two views, I would say, on this process is that what happens between acts of measurement. Either we have really excitons and photons, we just do not know whether our polariton is exciton or photon in this particular moment and in this particular place in the space. And this would be a materialistic point of view which was advocated by Schrödinger and Einstein, or as more or less everybody believes in this community, there is no exciton, no photon until you do the measurement. You cannot say what it is. And so the matter does not exist if you do not observe it. When you do measurement, you collapse your wave function to either photonic or excitonic state. And then you can speak about the outcome. But between acts of measurements, you are neither photon nor exciton. So this is all philosophic and all very old. So why I'm coming back to this discussion, because this discovery of bosonic condensates of exciton polaritons offers a new tool of studying this interesting problem. So if we would have just one exciton polariton in a given quantum state, then any kind of measurement would not help us. We can capture it as exciton, we can capture it as photon, but it would not give us any supplementary knowledge on what has been before. But if we have a bosonic condensate, this changes the situation. So let us look at this scheme. Suppose that we have a condensate with six quasi-particles, six polaritons in the condensate. So two possibilities are either some of them are excitons and some of them are photons. For example, excitons are white cats and photons are black cats. This is one possibility. And another possibility is that they are all identical and they are all exciton polaritons. In this case, when we do measurement, the result would be different. So let us see. In the first case, so statistical interpretation of polariton condensate, we have a total number of polaritons at each particular moment of time, which is equal to the number of excitons, white cats, plus number of photons, black cats. We do not know how many white cats, how many black cats we have, but this condition holds. We can admit that they possibly convert to each other. In the case of this exciton polariton picture, let's say Copenhagen school view, we have these identical particles, which are superpositions of excitons and photons. And if we want to speak about exciton fraction and photon fraction, which we can then detect, then they are linked, they are both proportional to the total number of exciton polariton. And the coefficients of proportionality are so-called Hopfield coefficients, which were introduced by Hopfield in the beginning of 1960s. They just tell us what is the weight of the excitonic component in the superposition state and what is the weight of the photonic component in the superposition state. So these are some constants. They do not fluctuate. They are not stochastic. These are just numbers. And they satisfy this normalization condition. So clearly, these two situations are not equivalent. And if we do this Gedanken experiment, thought experiment, we would see some difference. So the thought experiment is that we excite condensate in a microcavity with a pulse of light. So we create some exciton polaritons, no matter what is the quantum state here, but at least there are more than one on average. And then we do two measurements. We have here the photon counter, which counts photons emitted by the system. And we also apply electric field, which destroys excitons. So an exciton is decomposed into electron and hole pair. And these electrons and holes give contribution to the photocurrent, which is measured by ampere meter. So we compare, let us assume that we can do this experiment, which is not trivial, with a very good accuracy. So we have some noise in this photocurrent, some noise in this photoluminescence signal, and we can compare these two noises and see if there are any correlations between them. Now, what I would expect, if we are within the statistical model, then, of course, I would expect some correlations. Because, let's say, the number of black cats is correlated with the number of white cats. Okay, if I have whatever more white cats, I have less black cats, and the other way around. So signal of photoluminescence, which is proportional to the number of, for example, black cats, is correlated with the signal of photocurrent, which is proportional to the number of white cats. On the other hand, in case of this picture, we would expect naively no correlations, because in each case, we kill one cat, and all cats are identical. No matter we kill it converting it to photon, or we kill it converting it to exciton, we just kill it. And it does not affect anyhow the statistics of the remaining state. Yes? No. It depends on the detuning between your exciton and photon. Look, if you have exact resonance, so in this point, you would have half exciton, half photon state here, half exciton, half photon state there. So here it is, here it is written for the bulk crystal. So if you go, of course, to this point, you are entirely photonic. But in a microcavity, the advantage is that you have a confinement of light in this direction. So you can have the lowest energy state in the system, which is not at zero energy, but which is at some finite energy. So if you would move this parabola to this point so that you have the exact resonance, you will be half exciton, half photon. Then you can have any other proportionality depending on the detuning. Okay, so let me go forward. So these are all naive qualitative hand-waving arguments, but let us try to calculate something quantitatively. What we can calculate? We can calculate some correlators. Let's suppose we can really do this exciton and photon counting measurements. Then what can we measure? We can measure the exciton photon correlator, which is just the average product of exciton number to photon number divided by the product of averages. We can do a simple G2 measurement for photons, like in quantum optics, this G2 second order coherence measurement. We can do the same for excitons, which would be very tricky from the experimental point of view. And finally, from these three correlators, we can build a big correlator, big exciton-photon correlator, G-big, which is squared exciton-photon correlator normalized by exciton G2 and photon G2. So this quantity is interesting. I introduced it on purpose because then it will give some nice, it will be helpful for the following story. So let us see what would be these correlators in the case of the Copenhagen, let's say, interpretation of exciton polaritons, where we have polaritons which are not excitons, not photons. And in this case, our exciton photon operators can be represented just as linear combinations of polariton operators for upper and lower polariton branches in this way. So low is the annihilation operator of a polariton on the low polariton branch. CU is the annihilation operator of a polyatom on the upper polyatom branch. So this, let's say, simplest linear combinations, they allow us to express our correlators through polariton operators. And we take advantage of the fact that our condensate sits on the lower polariton branch, so the upper polariton branch is empty, which is why the expectation value of this upper operator or the number of particles on the upper state is zero. And this allows, after very simple algebra, to reduce our exciton photon correlator to something very similar to just G2 in quantum optics. So this combination, and of course the answers would depend on the statistics of our polyatoms in the condensate, but this will be all textbook answers. For the coherent state, this correlator would be 1. For the thermal state, it would be 2. For the number state, it would be 1 minus 1 over the number of particles, and so on. So no surprises. Interestingly, the big correlator, this G big SC, will be equal to 1 for any statistics. So for all these states, this big correlator is exactly 1. It is independent on the statistics. This is a formal algebraic result. So if it is 1, we can be sure that everything works correctly. We have polaritons. There is no any independent excitons and photons in the system. And our vision of polaritonics, as it was formulated by Hofeld and Agranovich 50 years ago, is perfectly correct. Now, of course, the most interesting thing would be if it deviates from 1. How can it deviate from 1? So let us put ourselves in a different logic, and let us allow for stochastic conversion of exciton to photon and photon to exciton. So let us work in the exciton-photon basis and describe our system by some density matrix which has diagonal elements, this P of N A and B, which depends also on time. N A is, let's say, number of excitons, and B is number of photons, so the other way around. So the probability to have NA excitons and B photons in the system may be found from this Master-Boltzmann equation, which can be derived from the general Liouville equation for the density matrix, but it can be also written from the common sense. So it allows for radiative decay, where we destroy 1 photon in the system, and it is characterized by some photonic lifetime, tau photon. There is also a possibility to destroy excitons, for example, by electric field, which is characterized by time constant tau exciton. And then we have to take into account this our stochastic conversion. So we introduce a new parameter, tau xc, which is a rate of stochastic exciton to photon and photon to exciton conversions. And accounting for the bosonic nature of our excitons and photons, we can write the corresponding term into this Master-Boltzmann equation in this form. So again, it is a simple algebra. And then we can work with this equation. We can solve it, assuming some initial state. For example, a coherent initial state or number state or anything. So let us see what it gives. So here we have these probabilities, probability to find N exciton and NA excitons and B photons in our system as a function of time in the absence and in the presence of this stochastic conversion. So in the absence means tau xc equal to infinity. And okay, we have some dynamics. Clearly, the dynamics of these probabilities changes in the presence of this stochastic conversion. It changes in a very clear way. Actually, the probabilities of all configurations corresponding to the same total number of polaritons, total number of quasi-particles in the system, become very close to each other. And this is very natural. If your excitons can randomly convert to photons and photons to excitons, then eventually all configurations, all possible configurations with a fixed total number of particles become, will have the same probability. So if you have 10 polaritons, the probability to have 9 excitons and 1 photons and probability to have 9 photons and 1 excitons would be the same, after all, if these stochastic conversions go, are quick. So this is what one would expect. Let us see what it gives for our correlators. So actually for our correlators, it is dramatic because the correlators strongly change as a function of time if we allow for the stochastic conversion processes. So even traditional G2, the photonic G2, which has been studied actually in these condensates, it strongly deviates from 1. We would expect G2 equal to 1 for the coherent state, but here we see that because of the stochastic conversion, it would go to something like 1.4. The exciton photon correlator would go below 1. But most interestingly, this big correlator, which is always 1 for any statistics of polaritons within the polariton model, let's say Copenhagen interpretation of polaritons, it will go down to 1/4. So this is a huge difference, factor of 4. So if it deviates, if we manage to do this experiment and we see that this huge G, big G deviates from 1, goes below 1, then it indicates that something happens, that there are these stochastic conversions, whatever it means. So the limiting case of very strong stochastic conversions, or very short tau XC, may be understood in terms of a classical model of two-coupled oscillators. So actually, if we have two coupled oscillators with amplitudes A and B, and we impose a condition of energy conservation, so that A squared plus B squared is some constant, N, then in case of fully random distribution of initial phases of these oscillators, we have this distribution function, P of A and B, which is simple delta function, which reflects this normalization condition with normalization factor. So then we can calculate all expectation values, and we can calculate, for example, our XC correlator, which is this quantity, and we obtain 2/3, which is exactly the limit we have here. So this is not unexpected, but still quite surprising if we think about it from the traditional point of view. Now, if we look at the spectrum of emission of this condensate, we can calculate two things. We can calculate the energy of the condensate because our stochastic processes, they do not conserve energy, strictly speaking. So the energy can be modified. And we can calculate the energy variance per particle. This gives the following thing. If initially our condensate was in this lower polariton branch, in this point, then due to stochastic conversions, it would go up in energy, and eventually it would arrive to the middle. So this is like weak coupling regime. In the weak coupling regime, there is no polariton branches, we have just this situation. So this is something which we would expect because naively in the weak coupling regime, coupling of exciton to photon is so weak that, for excitons live for some time without seeing photons, photons live for some time without seeing excitons. So this stochastic model of exciton to photon conversion would make sense. And effectively, this is what we see. So introducing this, let's say, hidden parameter, this tau xc, we can describe transition from weak to strong coupling regime. Now our point is that even in the strong coupling regime, possibly, these stochastic conversions do take place. Because we do not see from this reasoning that they immediately disappear, the tau xc would go to infinity if we are pass from weak to strong coupling regime. It is, I would not expect it. Of course, this all needs to be experimentally verified. So next thing we were thinking about was the experiment which would be easy to realize. Because one can count photons, but one can hardly count excitons. Splitting of excitons to electron hole pairs and then detection of photocurrent would imply very sophisticated measurements if you really want to have accuracy on one single electron level. So it is not impossible, but very hard. Much easier would be to do a purely optical experiment. So the next idea was to put the system in the regime of Rabi oscillations. In this regime, with a short pulse of light, you excite both polariton branches together, lower and upper branch, and then you observe beats between exciton state and photon state. Initially, your system is in the fully photon state. Then, on the frequency given by this splitting, it converts to excitons, then it converts back to photons, et cetera, et cetera. So this is a very well-studied phenomenon, experimentally observed even in 90s by many groups. So in this regime, what we propose to do, we propose to fix at the upper branch and at the lower branch, and at these particular selected frequencies, put two photon counters, and then measure correlations, intensity-intensity correlations between upper and lower polariton branches. So this is a perfectly realistic experiment, and quickly going through the theory, which is similar to what I described earlier, we come out with this, for example, for some given choice of parameters, these results for the correlators between lower and upper polariton branches, which are similar to what we observed for exciton-photon correlators. In particular, this big correlator, again, composed from two-color intensity-intensity correlator and single-color correlators for upper and lower polariton branches, this one, it strongly deviates from one. It would be one within this Copenhagen model, and then it would go to one quarter in the limit of strong stochastic conversions. So this brings me to my conclusions. So what I wanted to tell you is that stochastic exciton-photon correlation processes, conversion processes, are described, may be described by what we call ambitiously hidden variable, this tau xc, stochastic conversion time, tau xc, which so far was not studied, neither experimentally nor theoretically, to the best of my knowledge. So in the limit of tau xc equal to infinity, we have the traditional, let's say, quantum mechanical Copenhagen results for all correlators, and no surprises. But if this tau xc is less than infinity, if it is finite, then there are interesting things happen. In particular, if it is less than exciton and photon lifetime, but more than the inverse Rabi frequency, we have very strong deviations of all correlators from the Copenhagen predictions. And this big G correlator goes from 1 to 1/4, which is a huge effect. Then if this tau xc becomes very small, we have a transition to the weak coupling regime, which is a well-known effect. And the final result corresponds well to the weak coupling picture. So exciton photon conversion mixes actually two polariton branches and changes the energy of the condensate. So in a sense, it is not an energy conserving process. And where the energy goes, it depends on the micro model. It can be discussed. We just suppose that this process exists, but we do not explain where it comes from. And finally, in the regime of Rabi oscillations, the upper lower polariton correlator is expected to go below one due to stochastic processes. So this is something one should be able to check. So maybe it goes below one, maybe it sticks to one, but this is an experiment which can be realized on existing samples and within existing experimental facilities. Thank you very much.
Thank you.